Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Welcome. This is Pro-Life Berks, and our program is going to be on adoption and foster care. I'm Carolyn Bonkoski, your co-host, along with Kathy Kuhns, co-host, and we have two guests, two parents who are going to talk about this with us. We have both Elisabeth and Paul Laskowski, and also if you have any questions, you can phone in, and the number is 610-378-0426. And I'd like to start my questions with Paul. Paul, could you please tell us how the two of you met?
We actually met on the internet.
You're kidding.
There was a Catholic dating site that we met on, and our profiles were very similar, and ended up doing a lot of communication back and forth, and we ended up going on a hike that sealed the deal.
And how long have you been married now?
We're going on 14 years. Yeah.
14 years, and how many children?
We have four children right now.
By the grace of God.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about your children?
Sure. Our oldest is 8 years old, and our youngest is 2 years old. And two of our children are biological children, two of them are adopted children.
You have a picture with them?
Yeah, you have. The camera can show that your family is beautiful.
Thank you.
It's just beautiful.
There it is.
Okay. So you're a real expert on parenting. You're a perfect guest for this topic.
Thank you. Yeah, we dealt with infertility for about 5 years. So we were both interested in a big family, and it didn't come naturally to us. So we were in the adoption process before we finally conceived our oldest. And then when we had difficulties the second time around, it was easy to just jump back into the adoption process again. So we adopted back to back pretty quickly, and then eventually conceived again and had Claire.
And what agency did you go through?
So the first time we were working with Catholic Social Services, but we never received a placement through that. So the second time around, we decided to become foster parents, and it was a leap of faith, but Paul was willing to take that with me, so that was very helpful. And we work directly with the county, so we're foster parents for Berks County.
Great. So did you know that you would be adopting foster children
when
you started that, or did that just happen?
When we signed up for the foster care, we became an adoptive resource for the county. So in this situation, the cases that are most likely to go to adoption, we would be placed with one of those cases versus cases that might not be as likely to go there. They would go to other families who just wanted to foster.
What was that process like?
Trying it sometimes.
How long, what's the average, what was the length for you, and what is the average?
It really depends on each specific case. There's no average really. It depends on all the different factors in the individual case. As to the goal of fostering is reunification with the parents. So that's the first hurdle you have to get over, is that the goal of this is not necessarily to adopt, but the best thing is always for a child to be with their parents.
Right. Sure. Unfortunately, so you have to be ready for that.
Sometimes there are situations that the parents are unable to fulfill what they need to do. And so then that's when they turn to the foster system. And then for the situations that really seem like they're just not going to work out, then they end up going to adoption.
And how long did it take you for your two?
So for the first, it was about an 18-month process from the time that he was placed with us until his adoption. Our second was a little bit quicker. She was about probably 9 months from placement to adoption. So it all depends on the different circumstances and the family situations.
How did your children take to it?
Our oldest was so young when Blaise came to live with us. So she, was 2 years old. She didn't know any different. It's a more popular topic that we talk about in our family now that they're older and they want to know, I came from your belly, and Blaise and Mara know they came from our hearts. So you know, we have lots of books that we read to them that talk about adoption and the just, you know, the beauty and the suffering and the loss that come with it, but, you know, the gift of adoption to our family.
Oh. So. You have a YouTube you want to show us. Would you like to
have that
on now, your family?
We can do that. This was after the adoption of our second daughter. So this is a couple years old, but we'll just go ahead and start that on.
Felt this way before. Funny how you found your way to my door. And suddenly my prayers are coming true. These arms are not letting go of you.
Goodness, what a beautiful family. Would you explain to all of us, you have open adoptions, what's called an open adoption. Yes. Would you explain that to everyone?
Yeah, so open adoption is probably a very misunderstood, you know, I think probably most prospective adoptive parents are very scared of the idea. You know, obviously it's a different circumstance than maybe, you know, just parenting without an adoptive situation. You know, and it was one of the hurdles for my husband even being willing to be an adoptive parent. But the idea is that most adoptions that happen today are open to some extent because we do have access to each other's information. They know who we are. We know who they are. In the foster parent world, you know, not all circumstances allow for open adoption. But we do have an open adoption with my son's biological parents. So we see them twice a year. What that means is they have the benefit of seeing that he is well-loved and well-taken care of. And then he has the benefit of sort of knowing their real circumstances and knowing why he lives with us. So there is a benefit. We do have a relationship with my daughter's biological half-sister. And, you know, it's just the benefit of them sort of having access to some of that information for as they grow up and sort of discover who they are and where they came from. So.
Oh, that sounds like it's working.
Yeah, I mean, many years, like it used to be, everything was closed and you ended up with children, you know, pursuing and wondering and they develop kind of like a fantasy about how life would have been with maybe, you know, their biological parents. And what they find is that with open adoption, it really helps to quell that fantasy of what mm-hmm. it could have been like, because they're able to actually see what it mm-hmm. is like. You know, they actually do have a relationship and an understanding of that.
I think that gives them more security, too, knowing that they were loved and are loved, and that, you know, that they weren't just thrown away. And
right.
Yeah, that's yeah. nice.
I think for a perspective, for a birth mother, you know, that's the biggest thing is, you know, just that fear of what's going to happen if I place right. my baby for adoption. And, you know, for them to know that this is a possibility, that open adoption is something that may allow them to see that their child is well loved yes. and well taken care of, you right. know, and so that's.
And you know, we hear that when we do sidewalk counseling, and we hear that that is such a fear for many people, because they all, you know, usually all you hear are the bad stories, you mm-hmm. know, so it right. scares people, and they don't want to take the plunge. But I mean, what a perfect solution to a pregnancy that you may have been a little unexpected, but yeah. still that
and I think,
baby's life is preserved.
You know, as adoptive parents, you know, we have just so much respect for biological parents and, you know, those that do make that choice. And so kids that come into foster care, unfortunately, their parents are not always making the choice towards adoption. But in the case of my son's parents, they actually did at some point sign off their rights to us. So they did choose us, you know, as a part of the process as well, which was a really special thing between mm-hmm. us. So, you know, it's very nice that we have that relationship.
I think Paul had mentioned earlier when we were discussing things, he said he would love to have an army of children. Is that what you said?
Well, for me, it's always been, I just had, at some point in life, I just hit that where I felt called to be a father, you know? And once you open your heart to adoption or to fostering, it's hard to go back. And realizing that there are so many kids out there who need families and who need love. And there's a lot of commercials that you'll hear on the radio and TV now, you know, about you don't have to be the perfect parent, you just have mm-hmm. to be willing to love. And that's essentially what it is. You just have to have that open heart. And because a lot of the older kids, all they want is just a family, somebody to spend their holidays with, somebody, you know, siblings or you know, parents. And there's so many kids who need that. And yeah. So few
many,
people seem to be really
how many
aware.
Children did you mentioned earlier that are in foster care and up for adoption in Pennsylvania?
I think you mentioned yeah, 2,000
or
so.
I just read the statistic today. There are 2,000 waiting to be
Isn't
adopted.
You know, and I think 2000. The hardest thing is you know, having been in the infertility world and having so many friends that are still experiencing that, and knowing how many fantastic couples are out there that, you know, there's so much fear related to mm-hmm. making a decision towards adoption. But if you can open your heart towards the possibility, you know, and I always say, you know, there's a joke that most wives have to bring their husbands kicking and screaming into the process, you know. And
why
I told Paul, he's in now. Yeah, he wasn't in to begin
but it,
with.
But it was a struggle at first.
Yeah.
You know, you have to get over. Yeah, there's right. a lot of questions about this and that. And, you know, like from a Christian perspective, it for me, the turning point was just realizing that we're all adopted in God's family. So
beautiful.
What's the difference? You know, it doesn't really matter. Race, you know, it doesn't matter.
Right.
It's
Isn't well, there, go ahead.
You're such an example of fatherhood, and there is such a need for more men who would be willing to open their hearts to children, because, you know, they try to poo-poo the fathers and look at all these kids that are running around in gangs and trouble, and because they're in fatherless homes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So your role is crucial, really, to the development of a child,
and,
especially
and
boys.
We realize that we're not perfect parents. You know, we all make mistakes, but the fact is that you're there to love your kid, and you love them the best you can, and that will go an infinite distance in their lives, you know.
And doesn't Berks mm-hmm. County do a lot to help you to be a parent, to be a good parent, and for the child?
Actually, yeah, through the foster, BCCYS, the Children and Youth, they have their foster program is really, there's tons of resources for if you're considering being a foster parent. There's training, and there's, once you get into it and you have questions, there's parent associations, and there's just innumerable resources to help you do what you need to do. And really, the only thing you need is an open heart.
And though, also, if, when you're a foster parent, are there a lot of expenses involved with that?
So that's a good question. You know, and this wasn't something we truly understood. It was definitely a strong reason that we chose to become foster parents. And adoption outright could be $20,000-$30,000.
Really?
But through foster care, the expenses are paid for. So, you know, there is no cost. I think the extent of our expenses were to pay for our background checks. And then, you know, everything else is handled, including the adoption expenses. You know, the children
have access
to Medicaid.
That's really good for our viewers to know.
Yeah, so
if they are considering it, because that's quite a financial burden. I had no idea it cost that much.
Yeah, so foster care is free, and you know, it's such a gift to our family, and obviously they need foster parents because there's so many children that need homes. So,
and as you say, they get the medical assistance.
They get medical assistance. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of. There's a lot of state benefits, I guess, that come for them. So.
Okay, so it's not really a financial a burden
no.
on the parents.
Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
So.
And it's safe for the children, too. Didn't you say that they visit your home on an ongoing basis?
In the foster care process, when you sign up to be a foster parent, they have a series of training classes, mm-hmm. and then they actually do a visitation to your home to make sure that it meets the standards yes. of what they need. Uh-huh. You have fire extinguishers and fire alarms and, you know, food and water on hand and all that kind of, they have a bunch of requirements, but it's not over the top by any means. It's just mm-hmm. the basic things that a household should have. And they do, they have that. And then, so they do have a really
so
good check on it.
You found it very comfortable to work with Berks children and youth? We'll have to give them a plug.
Yeah, no, I say we're infertile in life, but we're very fertile as foster parents, you know, and I hate, you know, it's hard because there is a loss. And again, you know, that's the circumstances are not always great that the children are coming to our family. But, you know, it is such a gift for our family to be able to be open to having these children and, you know, for my children to have the gift of siblings and, you know, a loud, crazy family. So.
Yeah,
that they're a part of.
And if there are any kind of problems, you said there's a lot of resources and the county helps to.
Yeah, even post-adoption resources, you know, SWAN, Statewide Adoption Network has a lot of things for counseling or whatever the needs are of the child. And they really do support them through, I think, 18 years of life for sure.
Mm. So what's been the most difficult part of the whole process, would you say? Is it the beginning?
The hurdle you were talking about?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably the biggest hurdle. I mean, there's time commitments and, you know, but you have that in life.
Right.
You know, you could make any excuses to the hard parts or not. And, you know, there are sacrifices you have to make, but in the end, you would have to do those if that was your biological child as well. So
I say the biggest fear people have to becoming foster parents is they say, I could never grow so attached to a child and then let them go.
Yes, you hear that.
You know,
very
and
frequently.
I think my rationale has always been, unfortunately, you know, you have a risk of losing a child no matter what your circumstances are.
Right.
If you're pregnant, you know, there's the possibility of miscarriage and, you know, even traditional adoption, there's the possibility of changing, the birth mother changing her mind and a loss of that adoption. So, as foster parents, yes, there is that risk, you know, but we also take the hit of the risk and, you know, we are strong for the child and, you know, we're just praying for the best circumstance and outcome for that child.
What was your greatest joy?
I would say our adoptions.
Yeah.
I mean, just...
Adding another soul to our family that, you know, that God gave us the grace to be able to do that and to know that you've had another opportunity, you know.
They mm-hmm. you know, you stand in the courthouse, you know, when we've been able to have our friends with us and the judge asks you, you know, why do you want this child to become a part of your family? And, you know, you answer always in tears.
Oh, really?
I can't imagine any other situation. And they were, you know, they've always been a part of our family. So, you know, that moment where the judge puts the stamp on the paperwork and makes it official is a beautiful moment.
So do you have a big house? That you can fill it up with some more.
You just learn how to use your space efficiently.
There you go.
That's precious.
I understand you have a car seat in your car right now. Why is that?
Well, we are foster parents again, so we're always open to the placement of another child. So we are hoping that we are open to the possibility of another placement.
Okay.
We're on the ready.
Like you say, from the heart. Yep. Right? Yeah. Yeah, that is absolutely wonderful.
Are there many handicapped children that are in foster care?
They're definitely there.
There are in the SWAN program, I think a lot of the children that are more medically dependent. Mm-hmm. Surprisingly enough, there are people who feel called to mm-hmm. to deal with the most severe cases. One of our friends in foster care, Pam Hathaway, she deals with literally the most severe kids who can't talk or do anything for themselves that are completely bedridden. She would take them under her wing and
a lot of them into her family.
Yeah. She's a great example of, you know, just loving a child, you know, and just because they're a child, you know.
Yeah, I know a woman who specializes in newborns. She takes the newborns and she just nurtures them until a foster family could be found or an adoptive family could be found. That's all she does. Yeah. She's had hundreds of newborns over her lifetime. Yes, and she said probably the longest I think she's ever had a newborn before it was placed was about 6 months. Mm-hmm. Mm. But she just loves the newborns and she's just so good with the babies.
Yeah.
Where would you advise people to start if they're interested, or just if they can just learn a little bit more?
Yeah, so I definitely say that meetings are out there. Go to meetings. You know, if you want to contact your county and, you know, just ask them what's available and what training they offer. And, you know, it never hurts to go through training because I think you can always, you know, back out if it's not the right circumstance. But there's always training meetings and situations to just get that information, you know, to make the decisions for your family. Mm-hmm.
And that's a very important thing. Like, you can always say no, you know, before something happens, you know. If you go through the training, you decide that that's not the right...
Maybe it's not the right time.
Exactly, right time. Or maybe it's just something that you don't think you could do. You know, they do have all those trainings that give you the information beforehand, so you're not caught blindsided and oh, nobody ever told me about this. You know, the information is there. And... So if you decided that that's for you, that's great, and you could pursue it. And if not, you know. And two, like, if you are given a placement, you know, they call you and they ask you, you know, do you think you could take a child or not? Mm-hmm. And then you could say no if at that time it's not.
So
do you have any announcements?
For the mothers out there who are pregnant and are, considering what to do, adoption is the best option.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a gift.
It's just wonderful.
It's a gift all around. And I mean, I think our families connected with us would agree. You know,
it's a blessing. And you are saints. I don't care. They don't want me to call them saints, but you are. I think you're just a blessing to your children and to the community and for your witness. It's wonderful.
Thank you very
much. So we thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having
maybe
us.
We'll have you on again in a few years. Yeah. If your family's grown any larger.
Thank you for tuning
in. So that's our program for the evening. Do we have any announcements? I don't think we do right now. But we'll be back again in October and we'll see you then. Good night. Thanks for watching.
Goodbye.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.